Penguin Random House Audio presents Everything in This Country Must, a novella and two stories. This is the author, Colum McCann. For Isabella and John Michael and Christian. Horses buried for years under the foundations give their earthen floors the ease of trampolines. Paul Muldoon, Dancers at the Moy. Everything in this country must. A summer flood came and our draft horse got caught in the river. The river smashed against stones and the sound of it to me was like the turning of locks. It was silage time and the water smelled of grass. The draft horse, father's favorite, had stepped in the river for a sniff maybe, and she was caught, couldn't move, her foreleg trapped between rocks. Father found her and called, "Katie!" above the wailing of the rain. I was in the barn, waiting for drips on my tongue from the ceiling hole. I ran out past the farmhouse, into the field. At the river, the horse stared wild through the rain. Maybe she remembered me. Father moved, slow and scared, like someone traveling deep in snow, except there was no snow, just flood. And father was frightened of water, always frightened. Father told me, "Out on the rock there, girl." He gave me the length of rope with the harness clip, and I knew what to do. I am taller than father since my last birthday, 15. I stretched wide like love and put one foot on the rock in the river middle and one hand on the tree branch above it and swung out over the river flood. Behind me, father said, "Careful now, hi." The water ran warm and fast, and I held the tree branch, still able to lean down from the rock and put the rope to the halter of the lovely draft horse. The trees bent down to the river in a whispering, and they hung their long shadows over the water, and the horse jerked quick and sudden, and I felt there would be a dying, but I pulled the rope up to keep her neck above water only just. Father was shouting, "Hold the rope, girl!" And I could see his teeth clenched and his eyes wide and all the big veins in his neck, the same as when he walks the ditches of our farm, many cows, hedgerows, fences. Father is always full of fright for the losing of Mammy and Fiacra, and now his horse, his favorite, a big Belgian mare that cut soil in the fields long ago. The river split at the rock and jumped fast into sprays coming up above my feet into my dress. But I held tight to the rope, held it like father sometimes holds his last sweet afton at mealtime before prayers. Father was shouting, "Keep it there, girl, good." He was looking at the water as if Mammy was there, as if Fiacra was there, and he gulped air and he went down in the water to free the draft horse's hoof. And he was gone so long, he made me wail to the sky for being alone. He kept a strong hold of one tree root, but all the rest of his body went away under the quick brown water. The night had started stars. They were up through the branches. The river was spraying in them. Father came up spluttering for air with his eyes all horse wild and his cap lost down the river. The rope was jumping in my hands and burning like oven rings, and he was shouting, "Hold it, girl, hold it high. For the love of God, hold it, please." Father went down in the water again, but came up early, no longer enough in his lungs to keep down. He stayed in the river, holding the root, and the water was hitting his shoulders, and he was sad watching the draft horse drown. So I pulled hard on the halter rope, and the horse gave a big scream, and her head rose up again. "One more try," father said, in a sad voice, like his voice over Mammy's and Fiacra's coffins long ago. Father dipped under, and he stayed down as long as yesterday's yesterday, and then some headlights came sweeping up the town road. The lights made a painting of the rain way up high, and they put shadows on the hedgerows and ditches. Father's head popped out of the water, and he was breathing heavy, so he didn't see the lights. His chest was wide and jumping. He looked at the draft horse and then at me. I pointed up the road, and he turned in the flood and stared. Father smiled, maybe thinking it was Mac Devlin with his milk truck or Molly coming home from the sweet shop or someone come to help save his favorite horse. He dragged on the tree root and struggled out from the river and stood on the bank, and his arms went up in the air like he was waving, shouting, "Over here, over here, hi." Father's shirt was wet under his overalls, and it was very white when the headlights hit it. The lights got closer, and in the brightening, we heard shouts, and then the voices came clear. They sounded like they had swallowed things I never swallowed. I looked at Father, and he looked at me all of a sudden with the strangest of faces, like he was lost, like he was punched, like he was the river cap floating, like he was a big tree all alone and desperate for forest. They shouted out, "Hey, mate, what's going on?" in their strange way, and Father said, "Nothing." And his head dropped way low to his chest, and he looked across the river at me, and I think what he was telling me was, "Drop the rope, girl." But I didn't. I kept it tight, holding the draft horse's neck above the water, and all the time Father was saying, but not saying, "Drop it, please, Katie. Drop it. Let her drown." They came right quick through the hedge with no regard for their uniforms, and I could hear the thorns ripping back against their jackets. One took off his helmet while he was running, and his hair was the color of winter ice. One had a mustache that looked like long grasses, and one had a scar on his cheek like the bottom end of Father's hay knife. Hay knife was first to the edge of the river, and his rifle banged against his hip when he jumped out to the rock where I was halter holding. "Okay, love, you're all right now," he said to me, and his hand was rain wet at my back. He took the halter and shouted things to the other soldiers, what to do, where to stand. He kept a hold of the halter and passed me back to long grasses, who caught my hand and brought me safely to the riverbank. There were six of them now, all guns and helmets. Father didn't move. His eyes were steady looking at the river, maybe seeing Mammy and Fiacra staring back at him. One soldier was talking to him all loud and fast, but Father was like a derry window shop dummy, and the soldier threw up his arms and turned away through the rain and spat a big spit into the wind. Hayknife was all balance on the rock with the halter, and he didn't even hold the branch above his head. Ice Hair was taking off his boots and gun and shirt, and he looked not like the boys from town who come to the barn for love. He looked not like Father when Father cuts hay without his shirt. No, he looked not like anybody. He was very skinny and strong, with ribs like sometimes a horse has after a long day in the field. He didn't dive like I think now I would have liked him to. He just stepped into the water very slow and not show-offy and began making his way across, arms high in the air, getting lower. But the river got too deep, and Hayknife was shouting from the rock saying, "Stay high side, Stevie! Stay high side, mate!" And Stevie gave a thumb up to Hayknife, and then he was down under the water, and the last thing was the kick of the feet. Longgrasses was standing beside me, and he put Stevie's jacket on my shoulders to warm me. But then Father came over, and he pushed Longgrasses away. Father pushed hard. He was smaller than Longgrasses, but Longgrasses bashed into the trunk of the tree and hit against it. Longgrasses took a big breath and stared hard at him. Father said, "Leave her alone. Can't you see she's just a child?" I covered my face for shame, like in school, when they put me in class at a special desk, bigger than the rest, not the wooden ones with lifting lids, except I don't go to school anymore since what happened with Mammy and Fiacra. I felt shame, like the shame of that day in school, and I covered my face and peeped instead through my fingers. Father was giving a bad look to Longgrasses. Longgrasses stared at Father for a long time too, and then shook his head and walked away to the riverbank where Stevie was still down in the water. Father's hands were on my shoulders, keeping me warm, and he said, "It'll be all right now, love." But I was only thinking about Stevie and how long he was underwater. Hayknife was shouting at the top of his voice and staring down into the water, and I looked up and saw the big army truck coming through the hedgerow fence, and the hedge was broken open with a big hole, and Father screamed, "No!" The extra lights of the truck were on, and they were lighting up all the river. Father screamed again, "No!" but stopped when one of these soldiers stared at him. "Your horse, or your bloody hedge, mate?" Father sat down on the river bank and said, "Sit down, Katie." And I could hear in Father's voice more sadness than when he was over Mammy's and Fiacra's coffins. More sadness than the day after.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.